my name is State Representative Gina H. Curry, and I am a proud co-chair, founding co-chair of the Pennsylvania Black Maternal Health Caucus, and a founding member. And I will be serving as today's moderator. And so this is our inaugural Brunch and Learn, and it is around access in crisis. The establishment of the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus is a testament to the dedication of stakeholders and legislators, many who are on the line today, to address the disturbing trends of Black maternal health, mortality, and morbidity in our state here in Pennsylvania. As the third state coalition of its kind in the nation, our mission is clear: to pass the Pennsylvania Momnibus legislation. And it's a legislative package modeled after the federal Momnibus legislation. By doing so, we aim to change the trajectory of maternal health outcomes in Pennsylvania and for the better. Black Maternal Health Caucus Brunch and Learn series aims to create a consistent and collaborative space for legislators, stakeholders, and community members to convene and learn about contemporary topics related to Black maternal health. For our inaugural meeting, the theme is Access in Crisis. Through this program today, we hope to keep up the important conversations started on Maternal Health Awareness Day and learn how we can work together as legislators and stakeholders and community members to improve access across this Commonwealth. I'd like to start off by introducing our program speakers today. First, I would like to introduce my friend and speaker, Joanne Craig, who is the Chief Impact Officer for the Foundation of Delaware County. Joanne's work has impacted tens of thousands of families in Delaware County and across Pennsylvania. With several decades of experience working in public health, nonprofit management, and philanthropy, Joanne is considered a thought leader and advocates for maternal and child health services on a variety of coalitions like the Pennsylvania Perinatal Partnership, Persisker Initiative, I'm sorry I messed that up, the Pennsylvania Black Maternal Health Caucus, National Healthy Start Association, and the Nurse Family Partnership Administrators Innovation Committee. Wow, that's a mouthful. Joanne also serves as the co-chair for the Pennsylvania Maternal Mortality Review Committee. As Chief Impact Officer of the Foundation of Delaware County, Joanne administers the foundation's public health programs and nonprofit services for such as WIC, Healthy Start, Nurse Family Partnership, Housing Opportunities for Equity Program, known as HOPE here in Delaware County, Cribs for Kids, El Central Hispanic Resource Center, Drug-Free Communities, and Chester High School Health Resource Center. A graduate of the University of Delaware and Eastern University, Joanne holds a Master's of Science degree in Nonprofit Management. And Joanne is also a proud member of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated, an Athena awardee, and the recipient awards and recognitions from organizations such as the United Way of Greater Philadelphia, Southern New Jersey, Children's First, and March of Dimes, and much, much more. We definitely have a veteran advocate and activist on the line with us today. Welcome, Joanne. And then our second, but not anywhere to the least of Joanne, is LaQuisha Garland, a friend who I've gained in this work. She is a family in practice. She's from Family Practice and Counseling Network. She is the Director of Development and Social Innovations and Birth Center Project Lead. LaQuisha C. Garland, love the C, LaQuisha, because we got to put our middle initial in there, is a public health professional and maternal health advocate serving the Philadelphia area during her progressive 20-year tenure in the healthcare industry. She is the Director of Development and Social Innovation for the Family Practice and Counseling Network, FPCN. In anticipation of its opening in the fall of 2024, she is leading the community engagement strategy and marketing efforts while overseeing the design of the physical space and operations of the Family Health and Birth Center project. So proud of her for that. LaQuisha concurrently manages the operational oversight of FPCN, Anti-Racist, Justice, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. At AGEDI, that is that acronym, Health Equity Initiatives, Program Development, Fundraising, and Community Engagement Efforts. These efforts are critical in leading the interdisciplinary family health and birthing center project, a community solution in response to the maternal health crisis here in Philadelphia, as a key leader in this FPCN system. With 8 years of service, LaQuisha acts as a liaison between the network and community organizations representing FPCN while promoting its services, partnership opportunities, and its guiding principle that quality healthcare is a right and not a privilege. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Everybody can give a hand clap or a sign that we are excited to be here today. There we go. There we go. So our first discussion point as we move through is cultural competency in healthcare. Together, we will explore the importance of cultural humility and collaboration among healthcare providers to ensure that Black mothers receive respectful and culturally sensitive care. An unfortunate reality of the Black maternal health crisis is that it stems from systemic racism. Black women, no matter their educational, financial, or social status, are two to three times the risk of experiencing maternal morbidity and mortality. As a historically mistreated group, Black women need equitable and compassionate care. What work, this is a question to our panelists, what work is being done to ensure organizations and providers can provide culturally adequate care to the populations they provide? I don't know who wants to go first, Joanne or LaQuisha.
I'll start, Gina. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. I'm really happy to be a part of this panel. It is an amazing thing to do this work with you and LaQuisha and many of the others. So what's really important is not just cultural competency, but cultural congruence. And so it's not just the learning about a specific population or a culture, but it's making sure that the providers, those that are providing the services, look like and have had the same lived experiences where possible regarding the population that we're serving. Also, that we remember that we're all humans, right? We're all human beings, and that we should want to treat others like we would want to be treated. To be able to receive someone well, to be able to listen to them and hear why they're here, how we might be able to help them, what their needs are, what their concerns are, to listen very carefully and to be very thoughtful when we're interacting with and responding to folks and when we're offering suggestions. Starting with us as human beings first and recognizing that it's important to receive that person as a start.
That's great. LaQuisha, same question to you. What work is being done to ensure organizations and providers that they can provide culturally adequate care to the populations they provide? And I just want to say something really quick. We are recording this, so if everyone can turn off their cameras and stay on mute, just so the panelists can be highlighted, I think it's really important as we record, because this will be available for everyone to see. So while the panelists are speaking, if everyone could turn off their cameras, so that we can highlight the panelists so they're easy to see. LaQuisha.
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. And I echo Joanne's sentiments and just thanking you, Rep. Curry, and to the PA Black Maternal Health Caucus for this opportunity to have this discussion today. This is a loaded question, and there's so much to unpack with this in regards to what cultural competency even is. As we think about serving Black and Brown people and understanding the experiences of Black and Brown people here in this country, let alone at the hands of the healthcare system. When we think about, what it means to provide equitable care, there's so many different pathways we can, explore when it comes down to that. Absolutely, what Joanne is talking about in regards to cultural congruency, that's absolutely necessary. In addition to that, what we also understand is that this is a systems issue. And we also have to understand that pathways for more Black and Brown people to occupy the spaces of providing this care to begin with. What we know is, there's that implicit bias that happens. We hear about that in systemic racism and all of the awry experiences that people are facing, within healthcare. There's also something called affinity bias, where we also understand that the people who look like the people that are being served, outcomes are improved. And so to be able to diversify the medical care force is definitely something that's crucial and that's needed. But I think just going back to what Joanne was talking about, I can't just stress that enough and echo that enough, just the respect and dignity and self-worth of individuals, just as you would want to be treated. When you think about, if I'm sending, I think about what I send my mother here. that's the guiding, principle for me, what I send my child here. Right. For those, who may not have, I think just to understand, humanism comes first. Mm-hmm. And I know that for some people in this country, that's still, a challenge to feed. And so holding folks accountable when things like this don't happen. And I think also empowering people to be able to about their RE experiences is something that needs to be done a bit more. We're starting to hear there's a groundswelling of, folks who are actually doing this work, folks who are, advocates, serving as advocates, for families who are, whether it's, in maternal care or whether it's family care or wherever it is, because we understand that, this didn't happen overnight. We understand, who we are as Black and Brown people from the African diaspora and what that means, to be surviving here in the United States of America. Cultural congruency, I'll echo that, what Joanne talked about, is certainly something that should be promoted more.
No, that's
if I could add,
sure.
Add something.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
As we're working toward making sure that in the right places and spaces that the practitioners are representative of the population that they're serving, there are still ways to help all of us get there, right? And so I'd also like to suggest that to achieve cultural congruency, surely we want to see more Black and Brown folks in medical school, in nursing school, and so on, in all of these clinical professions, so that they can be in the right places and spaces where folks are being served. But there are also opportunities to partner with community-based organizations who are, in fact, perhaps led by Black and Brown folks, and who are employing folks from the community, who are employing folks that look like those that they serve. And so considering all of the options and not just kind of one pathway to get there, because we can't wait. You know, Black and Brown folks are in front of folks right now. They are demanding respectful, appropriate, culturally congruent services right now. So stepping outside of the box or stepping outside of your doors to find other opportunities that will allow you to make sure that folks can be supported, can be cared for, and are heard.
Absolutely. Thank you for that, both Joanne and LaQuisha. I think, you know, in thinking about this very topic, when looking at cultural competency in healthcare and access, we really have to think about the fact that, you know, providers need to know who they're serving. You need to know. So, you know, when we were having our discussion, our pre-discussion yesterday, I talked very candidly about, going into my own provider, who I love, adore, think he's one of the best. But like every time I would come into the room, which would be every year, right? He didn't see me regularly. Thank God I didn't have any issues where he would have to see, but he would, you know, be flipping and to the fact that they push a lot of patients in to see these providers in one day. He probably didn't even have time to look at my file to say, okay, this is Gina Curry. You know, I know that she's on this birth control. She's here. She's had three children. Instead, he walks in right away and says, so what birth control are you on now? And I laughed. I chuckle. And I tell this story a lot. I chuckle. And I was like, well, if you don't know, then we're in trouble because you gave me a tubal ligation after my third child. So we're going to be in a lot of trouble if you don't know what birth control I want. So these are some of the things that when we talk about, you know, having transparency with our patients, looking at their files, knowing who they are, right? Mm-hmm. Just like HR, like, you know, your staff, the folks who work for you, and you may keep a file. That's what they do in the doctor's office. But why aren't they taking a look? Why aren't they saying, okay, we know this person might have this type of anxiety around this type of service, right? And, or here's this person's history. Oftentimes when we go into a doctor's office, they ask us what our medical history is. They ask us what our family's history is, like our mothers or our aunties or whoever. Why don't we talk a little bit more about, you know, culturally what impacts us and how we want to be treated? And I think that is on the responsibility of the care providers. What are your thoughts?
It certainly is. And, you know, just going back to the conversation that we were having yesterday, it's team-based care as well, right? Because the sole responsibility isn't on that one provider. There's a team of people, you know, it takes a village, right? You know, to care for a family. So, you know, it's the provider who's also talking to the nurse, who's also talking to the medical assistant, who may be conversing with the CHW, the community health worker, who may be talking with the social worker. Because, you know, what we also have to keep in mind is, just like you talked about, Rep Curry, tailored approaches to care. There's no one size that fits all. Each of us are individual and unique and have our own different sets of needs. And then when you take into, you know, account, you know, someone who may be of immigrant status or someone who may be, you know, in a rural location, you know, where resources are hard to come by, we have to really leverage, you know, and think about, you know, I think of it as a wellness neighborhood. Right. Or a wellness village. Right. You know, if we can't serve you here, or if you have a need and we know we don't have that here, then I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to call my neighbor, you know, so and so, to go ahead and make sure that you have fresh fruits and produce to put on your table to eat. Right. I want to make sure that I consult with, you know, social supports to ensure that you have clothing for yourself and for your baby, period supplies, diapers, right? You know, all of these things are need, housing. Oh gosh, housing, right? Stable housing, you know? So it really does take what you talked about, just listening and just really being attentive to what the needs are of each individual and their families. Because other than that, what are we really doing? Are we really imposing, you know, improvement, or are we causing harm? Right. And so that's one of the things that I really am proud of that we do at FPCN. You know, we really model integrated, you know, healthcare supports, and, you know, and also talking through like that mental health support as well. That's certainly crucial and needed. So, you know, for us to be able to leverage, you know, all of our resources, you know, in this whole thing to really help move people forward.
Fantastic. How about you, Joanne? On the same topic of what it looks like as a wholeness space, right? What's that look like?
So I think about our theme for today, you know, maternal health in crises, right? And I tell this story about learning about the Japanese symbol for crises being the combination of the symbols for danger and opportunity. And so there's some opportunities here, right? And to the point that LaQuisha made, it really does take the village. And so I'll go back to my point about, you know, even if a practice is culturally congruent and the providers there are Black and Brown and they're caring for a Black and Brown community, they can only do so much, right? And we know that there's some limitations with time and really what you can know. So I will again say, I think partnerships, bringing that village together, right? Everyone and anyone that can help to care for that person. And when you combine the clinical practitioners with those who are working to provide supportive services, and it's the group or collective effort to care for that person, you get to build relationships. Relationships take us very far, don't they? Right?
Yeah.
Because it's no longer transactional. You learn to care about that person, and you're hearing more the big picture and not just kind of, you know, what's right in front of you. You get to see the forest. You don't just see the trees. And for most of us, there's so much that gets in the way before we can even get to healthcare, right? Whether it's just that you stubbed your toe getting dressed, or you couldn't get your child to, you know, wear the clothing that you wanted them to wear so you could make the bus on time to get to the appointment. And so just understanding that we are all living our lives as we work to get to that appointment, but there's so much going on. And often there's so many issues and needs that are happening that aren't in our view. And so if we have this village that's the effort, I think we get to see more, we get to hear more, we get to learn more. But I also believe that we actually get to do a better job of really helping people, really addressing their needs, meeting them where they are, which is so, so important when it comes to just taking care of someone, right?
Absolutely. And I think with everything that you all said around this particular topic, one thing that I did want to highlight as we move on to the next question is that it's a harmful practice. And this is from one of our staffers, you may know, it's a harmful practice if we attempt to master others' cultures, because it limits the availability for growth. And that simply means we, you know, when people think about cultural competency, I talk about it all the time with one of my rep colleagues, Rep Young. Cultural competency is it's essential. It's necessary. But the one thing that we do know, if you feel like you've mastered, and this goes back to some of the policy that we've been talking about with, you know, having, you know, trainings and cultural competency. Everybody has been on the computer and had to click, oh, I've done this training. Here's the facts. You will never master someone else's culture because we always have room to grow. And so with Black maternal health, we find that this is the breeding ground for a lot of the devastation that we're seeing. Oh, we know who they are. They, you know, contain pain. We're not listening. Because they feel like they know. And that's for people who are in the same culture as well. We all need to learn. And so as we end on that particular topic, I think it's important for us to highlight the facts that we need to be able to be open and have an open space for learning about others. Mm-hmm. Key. Right? Key. And so I just want to thank everyone again for getting on. We are up to over 80 participants. This is so exciting today. We have just, for those of you who have just jumped on, we have just finished our first question and answer around cultural competency in healthcare and the barriers and access to care. And the second question with Joanne and LaQuisha, I want to talk about the second discussion points. And we're asking folks to keep their questions. So if you have questions, throw them in the chat. We're going to hopefully be able to have time to get to some of the questions. The second discussion point are barriers to prenatal and postpartum care. As you see on the screen, when you see a mama who is having a baby, it's a very humanistic thing. So I just want everybody to focus their eyes on this young woman who has this baby that she's carrying, and just picture yourselves for a moment, understanding what she could possibly be enduring at this moment, carrying another life, preparing herself, maybe all the pressures. And so when we are identifying and addressing the barriers that prevent or limit access to maternal health care for Black mothers and the community-based solutions working to combat these issues, we have to think about the mamas. We have to actually take a look. I don't know about you, I have chills because that's the emotional person that I am, but I'm looking at her and really understanding. She may have some concerns. She may have some burdens. She may have some barriers to her care. She might not have that village that we just talked about, because we know a lot of people move in their journeys and they're alone in it. But what we want to do is talk about the providers and the folks that can be that village for folks and having that access, right? We know a lot of us live in areas right now, mine in particular in Delaware County. We don't have access. Our folks, if someone in my household was having a baby, we would have to take several buses, right, to get to the hospital or to the care provider that we need to get to if we are staying in Delaware County. And then if we're hopping over to Montgomery County, we still have to take several buses. If we're hopping over to Philly, we still have to take several buses. And I'm in an urban area, or I call this urban suburban, where you feel like this access should be very readily available, and it's not. So in looking at this particular issue, we wouldn't just give you some statistics. And as we know all too well, there are numerous obstacles a woman or a birthing person must face to receive maternal health services that are geographically and financially appropriate for their needs. More than 2.2 million U.S. women ages 15 to 44 live in maternity care deserts. Let me repeat that. More than 2.2 million U.S. women between the ages of 15 and 44 live in maternity care deserts, meaning their county has no hospitals that provide obstetric care, birth centers, OBGYNs, or certified nurse midwives, according to the March of Dimes. The March of Dimes has identified 6 PA counties that are considered maternity care deserts, and 13 more have moderate access to care. While Delaware County retains an accessible status, we are combating the closure of our local hospitals that provide maternity health services, putting additional stress on families and the hospitals in nearby counties that we've seen. And I must just speak to that for a tiny bit. Mm-hmm. I delivered 3 children at Lincoln. It's really 20 minutes from me in a car. Let me say that again. In a car, I can get to Lincoln. Lincoln, I know, I'm just calling them out, maternal, Mainline Health. Excellent experience for me there having my children, but they're overwhelmed. We have taken DCMH out of that space to deliver care, and now folks are going over to Lincoln. And so this supports a crisis. It supports a crisis. And this comes from the Maternity care desert in Pennsylvania in 2021, this information. What barriers do Black mothers uniquely face when seeking prenatal or postpartum care in Pennsylvania? And LaQuisha and Joanne, how do we serve the uninsurable, folks that aren't citizens, folks that are not documented, folks that have moderate income? Because we talked about it earlier, it doesn't mean that you have to be poor to have this situation. Nope. You can be middle class, you can, you know, be an educated person. We have to keep putting that in people's minds, because just like this young lady who's up on the screen, you may be thinking, oh, what's her socioeconomic? I wonder if she, you know, she has a nice bedroom, she's sitting on a nice bed. Is that in the hospital or is that her house? We have all these preconceived notions about folks. So what does this look like, LaQuisha and Joanne, from your perspective and then the work that you've done and seen?
Well, as we're talking about access to care, I mean, when you think about what's happening here in Philadelphia and surrounding counties, Delco, 12 hospitals closed since 1992, right? And then when we think about diving deeper, because I wrote this down, 14 of Philadelphia's 19 obstetric units closed since 1997. And there's many reasons why. When we think about maternal health in a hospital, it isn't necessarily bankable, you know? And so it isn't a priority. And so what we're seeing now is a shift in regards to, in addition to people's RE experiences in a hospital setting, because there's so much work that needs to be done in the healthcare system, in the healthcare industry. But what we're seeing is a groundswell of alternate places and spaces to give birth, home births, birthing centers, and there's not enough of them.
I think there's 5 in the Commonwealth. I think we figured that out. Yeah.
There's 5.
And yours will be 6, right?
We think so. However, you know, when we think about what that means for people and who are planning to give birth, what are the options, right? And then now we're faced with having to choose a hospital. And I think you called it out, Rep Curry, where folks, you know, because there's such a groundswell, because there's such an influx due to the downsizing of places to give birth. So now I'm up against, you know, having a terrible experience. This doctor may not even had time to read my record before I walked in this room. You know what I mean? And so we're finding ourselves cutting corners just to be able to meet productivity demands. So again, it's all of the things. It's all of the systems. It's the capitalism that also happens here in this country. And people are being ignored and lives are being lost as a result of it. And so, you know, when you think about what we can do, you know, there are, you know, community health organizations, FPCN being one of them, you know, who strive to really meet this need. You know, we have family planning health services, we have prenatal and perinatal health services, but that's still not enough. There's also beautiful people, birth workers and organizations that are doing the due diligence, you know, who are out here trying to help families, whether they're at the home, or doulas, you know, doula training programs, you know, folks like the Earth app who are, you know, basically compiling all of these different places, you know, and giving ratings, you know, as per people, you know, and their experience, so that folks can have more of a informed decision when they're picking places to give birth. You know, there's wonderful people like Once Upon a Preemie and, you know, Janae Johns, who's doing her due diligence with, you know, really working to make impact in regards to, you know, trainings, you know, within the hospital care setting. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I don't want to feel like I'm on a Grammy stage, right? Because I'm going to forget, because people are doing the wonderful things. Yeah. There are things that are being done. What I feel, though, is that there just isn't enough awareness raising of all of these resources that are out here. Oh. And so, you know, call to action, PA Black Maternal Health Caucus, you know, to really help our families, to help folks across the Commonwealth, you know, in identifying who these stakeholders are, you know, whether that's in Philadelphia, whether that's in Allegheny County, wherever it is, you know, because there's, you know, folks from a systems, a magnitude, you know, systems level, and then folks who are doing the due diligence, you know, on a grassroots level, making impact nonetheless. And so
thank you so much.
Being able to just call those out. You know, we have the Maternal Wellness Village as a conglomerate of everybody from doulas and, you know, lactation consultants. We have folks like Coco Life who are out here doing the due diligence and, you know, providing people with doula trainings and, you know, supports. We have the Petaway Foundation who continues to pave the way. You know,
LaQuisha is dropping names, y'all. She's so dropping names. I don't want to interrupt you, but we got to give Joanne a chance. I appreciate the name drop because, listen, these grassroots organizations are key. And we love all of you all that are on here. We love you all for doing this work. Joanne, I appreciate you, LaQuisha. Joanne, what do you have to say on this? This is critical information that we've just put forward.
Sure. So to LaQuisha's point about access and providing information or being at a point where folks can turn to a resource to gain information, you know, I look at this photo and my first instinct is to ask this young woman, are you okay? What's happening? Not what's wrong, but what's happening? Mm. Is there some way I can help? Right. And so, you know, the first barrier in my view is information, right? And awareness about what's available to you, no matter where you are in the Commonwealth, no matter what your circumstances are. And so back to that village again, right? Making sure that everybody knows about the resources. And LaQuisha, I love all of those folks that you've mentioned as well and know them well, but there's so many more of these wonderful resources that are led by Black and Brown folks across the Commonwealth and more, that are staffed by Black and Brown folks across the Commonwealth and more. And we want to make sure that folks know information is so powerful. And so when we were talking yesterday and made the suggestion that the Black Maternal Health Caucus might be that repository for where folks can turn, I know here at the Foundation for Delaware County, we have multiple programs from WIC to Healthy Start and Nurse Family Partnership, our HOPE program. We have doulas as well. What we do is there's an interdisciplinary team. So it's a team effort, right? But a big part of what we do is making sure that folks know that we exist, making sure that folks know that when they connect with us, that then they get to connect with all of our resources, like our medical legal partnership as an example. But a lot of what we're doing here in Delaware County is replicated elsewhere. Here in the Commonwealth, there is a wonderful resource that's funded by federal MCV or Maternal Infant and Early Childhood Home Visiting Funds that are here to support birthing people and families with young children. And so there are many other of our peer organizations like the Maternity Care Coalition that is serving several counties here in southeastern Pennsylvania. So many of us are doing this work.
Yes.
But we're well-kept secrets. And so we want to resolve the barriers to care, access to care, providing folks like this young woman support if that's what she needs. We need to know what's out there. We need to know who's available. We need to know if someone's got a waiting list or if someone is ready and open and can receive new patients, new clients. We need to know if someone doesn't have a lot of needs that, you know, they can go here. But if someone has mental health issues and they're homeless, maybe they're well placed to touch or be touched by this organization over here.
Yes.
So again, the village concept, right? We need to know the resources, we need to know how to put folks in touch with them, and we need to encourage folks to be connected to them, because then that village can embrace them, can surround them. And that's how we're able to reduce barriers. That's how we're able to increase knowledge and awareness and increase connection so people can get what they need.
And guess what, ladies? We can do this. It is possible. All the things that we talked about today are possible. And I, you know, again, just want to give a huge, huge, huge shout out to Representative Mays, who is on the line, and Representative Cephas, who have been doing this work, right? Who have been doing this work for a long time. And all of you, every stakeholder, every organization that is represented today, want to just continue to give you encouragement. We want to put that fire underneath you when the fire feels like it's going down because it just feels discouraging. We are here as the PA Black Maternal Health Caucus to make sure that we are being engaged throughout our communities, that we are sharing the knowledge of who these organizations are. We did a lot of name dropping today, ladies, and that's a great thing. And so I would encourage everyone to continue to do that name drop. Hey, what is this organization? Hey, this is what's going on here. Hey, did you know about this program? Because like I said before, and I've said on many meetings, we can't start elbowing. Because we have to walk on this journey together. We have to pull behind us and pull that person up that may feel like, hey, I'm not getting the funding. You know what? I'm going to have to close my doors. That happened right in here in my district, you know, with Petaway. I'm going to name drop her because she's been working really hard to keep her doors open. I know Pam, I saw Pam on the line, who is the head of her board. These are real stories, right, of stakeholders who are involved in this game who may not have funding. We need to put this to an end because they are the ones, all of these stakeholders who are on the line, all of these orgs who don't get these grants the way they should to do this work. We need to continue to lift them up. And I think and I know that the governor's administration and the secretaries, they've heard it. They hear it. This is something that we're here to bring forth with this Brunch and Learn, and the next one, which I'm just going to shout out right now, is on March 22nd, and we will be putting out information. But right now, we want to leave open the floor. We have about 15 more minutes to have additional conversation. I'd love it if you all could take a screenshot of what's up on the screen right now, because I would really love for us to be able to see one another again, you know, as we're doing the question and answer. If the person who has the question, put that in the chat, we'll talk about it. And if there's anything else that folks have questions about, we decided to make this a time where we can actually have a discussion with all of you instead of continuing to answer more questions. I think today the cultural competency discussion and the access, the barriers and the access are really critical as we leave this conversation today to go ahead and think about how you can be a supporter, an innovator, someone who makes things move, you know, continue to advocate based on our discussion today. So, if there are any questions, I'm just going to look over at the chat. There's a question from Angela Fleming. Is there a place to find the grants to assist with nonprofits that are doing this work? And I believe, I was looking.
Gina.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I have the good fortune of being with the Foundation for Delaware County, so I can speak a little bit to Delaware County. But I'll just note, before I came to the Foundation and was running our public health programs, I can say I lived on the other side, right? So I know what it's like to develop and implement programs and write grants. And so I'm glad I'm able to kind of bring this view to our work here in the Foundation. So I'll say for those who are serving Delaware County, whether you're based here or you're providing services, the Foundation for Delaware County wants to support nonprofits, whether we provide you with a grant or through our Center for Nonprofit Excellence. We have nonprofit services. So we absolutely want to engage with nonprofits to find out what their needs are. And as much as we can share with them about funders, connect them with funders. We're a convener and a connector too. We are a member of the Pennsylvania Health Funders Collaborative. So we know folks all across the state. Happy to make some introductions. We have public and private grants. So we know a bit about the public space as well as about the private funding space. So I say to folks, you know, give us a call, right? And Mishika Warren is our Director of Nonprofit Services here. We have office hours, and we certainly would love to talk to nonprofits and see if we can help in any way. So that's a start. Our peer funders in the state, I believe, are open in the same way, and they want to engage with nonprofits that are serving their community. And Gina, as you said, you know, we've gotten to know the Secretaries of Human Services and the Acting Secretary of Health and leading the Department of Drug and Alcohol Prevention. So even helping to make some introductions there to learn more about public funding that's available in the state. In some of my remarks, I mentioned the McVee program. And so through the joint venture between the Departments of Education and Department of Human Services, OCDEL, there's some funding opportunities there for perhaps some of the community-based nonprofit organizations that are serving birthing people.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Joanne. I think there's another question in the chat around the Southwest Birthing Center. Someone asked, when will it be open and what does the timeline look like? And LaQuisha, I believe you would be the one to answer that.
I'd be happy to. So I'll go and just start off and saying, you know, money, okay? You know, for us, this has been, wow, an 8-year venture having to be displaced to a building not being conducive to birth center operations, to COVID stifling this project for 3 years, to now going through city proceedings with the water department in regards to how we're going to manage stormwater runoff. So it's been a constant moving target just in regards to the timeline. However, we steer the course because we know that, you know, this is a piece of a community solution, and we know that, you know, folks, you know, could certainly benefit from a model like this. So we look forward to opening our doors. We're going to say today at 12:49 p.m. on February 16th, we're going to say, you know, winter of 2025. And the reason for that is, again, just because of the city regulations and guidance that we have to abide by, which is very antiquated. We're literally blazing the trails in regards to this type of model of integrated healthcare services within a birth center setting. The services that we look to provide in this birth center is certainly, first of all, with FPCN being a nurse-managed facility, staying true to that model in regards to hiring midwives, you know, to do the service lines, and then also, you know, consulting, you know, with our partners, you know, in regards to, you know, transitional care nursing, CIAB care, and then, you know, with MCC, for example, for, you know, community health worker, but then also doula supports, you know, in-house, in addition to lactation consulting and all of the other things that need to be there to really wrap our arms around patients and families and mamas and birthing people. So in short, we'll call winter of 2025. And thank you so much for your support. You know, contact information is here. Just in regards to, you know, what you can, you know, just learn about more about the project. We'll be putting out, you know, some additional information as, you know, developments ensue. Thank you for your support in advance.
Thank you, LaQuisha.
Gina,
yes.
I'd like to offer two more pieces of information related to kind of technical resources and funding. There is the Pennsylvania Doula Commission, as well as a rising group related to community health workers. So I'm happy to put folks in touch with those groups. And then there's more. And in the chat, I see, you know, a kind of a thought, wouldn't it be nice to be able to have the collection of perinatal health resources in one place that folks can get to. And again, I think that that's also something great that the PA Black Maternal Health Caucus
Yeah, that's fantastic. Thank you so much. You know, when we think about other discussion points, as we have a few more minutes left, around what we need to be really looking at, you know, discussion points around, you know, what Governor Shapiro proposed as an investment in maternal health care. Is it adequate? You know, we have, you know, these are real questions. This is a brunch and learn. I mean, really to consider, you know, when we are doing out here doing this work, what does it look like? We have so many needs. We have deserts that need mobile care attention. I know I just set up with one of my colleagues in this area and the health department, a chance for women to receive mammograms with the mobile van. Well, we need mobile vans who can take care of perinatal care, can take care of breaking down those barriers, right? And so when we think about the funding, we know what works, but the resources are not really there to support this work. If we think about, you know, our small grassroots efforts being closed, their doors being closed, where will people get these resources? I remember bumping into Pam and Teresa when I was out at the Mitzvah Circle, which is in Montgomery County, and it's far away from my county. But shout out to the Mitzvah Circle, who serves about five different counties. They pick up Pampers, right? And I remember I didn't know Pam and Teresa from Petaway were going to be there. And I looked up and I saw them and I was like, oh, what are you doing out here? And they were like, oh, this is one of our resources to get Pampers. And thank God for that resource, because they were able to bring that resource all the way back to Delaware County in Lansdowne, where they have Pamper giveaways for that care, right? We talk about that initial care. So just to give a shout out there, it's really important that we continue to stay on the funding source, that we continue to advocate. You know, you all are going to be coming up for Black Maternal Health Week at the Capitol, Monday, April 15th to the Wednesday, April 17th. You know, stay tuned for more. But we really need to be advocating. And it's not just with the reps that are on this line. It's with our counterparts who need to understand the importance of this work. This is a bipartisan effort, Gina, to change the way our Commonwealth deals with maternal care. Yes, Joanne.
Your point is so, so important. In Pennsylvania, across Pennsylvania, in big and little ways, we know what works. We know the work to be done. We need the financial resources to support these efforts. Something that's working in Scranton, right? That we can bring to another area of the state.
Absolutely.
You already have the expertise there to help raise it up.
Absolutely.
This
Absolutely.
Has to be everybody's priority.
That's
we
everyone.
Need to demand it now. Not ask for it, but demand it.
That's
because
it.
We've
That's
waited
it.
Too long. We waited in line. You know, we've asked for a little bit of what we think we need.
Yeah.
We need more money to do more, to support whatever it is that will help. And we need to do this for birthing people, for women, for those who want to have children and have children and need to be here in Pennsylvania.
Go ahead, LaQuisha.
Mm-hmm. I was just going to say thank you, Joanne, for raising that, because it's not enough. It's not enough. A few million dollars. You know how much this birth center costs? This birth center costs $5 million.
Correct.
In itself. So,
correct.
You know, when we talk about a few million dollars, that's a drop in the bucket in regard to the entire Commonwealth. And okay. So, you know, when we also think about these funding streams, and I'm looking forward to, you know, compiling all of these different foundational grants and state grants and, you know, the like. And Joanne, thank you for naming all of those today. But it's not fair, because it's not fair. We're operating as crabs in a barrel, because everybody is out to try to do the same thing. Everybody is in this mission to help save lives of Black children and women. And it's not fair that we're competing for the same pots of money. And so when we talk about, you know, the ideas of coalition building, because again, it's about leveraging resources. It's working together. We talk about this, you know, these wellness neighborhoods and wellness villages. And so for us to be able to just leverage, you know, if I have this and you have that and you have that and you have that, now we put it all together and now we have a wonderful recipe and we all can, you know, serve. And so, you know, I'll also just, you know, just name that as another call to action as well as we, you know, continue to compile and continue this conversation around, you know, best practices. Thank you, Joanne, for raising that as well. Best practices, because people are doing this. They're doing it. When we think about, you know, those who have paved the way, and again, that way foundation, when we talk about, you know, reimbursement for doula support services, we need more of that. We need more of that to really help move and improve outcomes. Right. And I don't want to, and I stress that this is not a doula issue. Doulas are not the ones, we can't put this all on the backs of doulas, right? But at the same time, they are out here doing the due diligence. And so we need to ensure that they have a living wage, an equitable wage to be able to do so. But I'll just say, listen, I think strength in numbers. And I feel like, you know, I'm looking forward to the day when we all march on Capitol Hill and do the work that needs to be done, because we really, really need to stress that this is a human issue. This is not just her issue, her issue. This is all of our issue. When we're talking about, when we're talking about families and giving birth, this is a community issue. And so, you know, families need to be well so that communities can be well.
Yes.
That's right. That's right. We, you know, when maternal health is prioritized, it is a community health that strives. It's community health that really comes together. We can't do any of it. And in our last minute, I just want to lift that up. I want to thank LaQuisha C. Garland. And I want to thank Joanne Craig, because, you know, this fire that we heard in the last few minutes is the fire that we need.
Yes.
As Joanne said, we no longer need to ask, we need to demand, because this is a life and death conversation. This we know is happening. And I just want to lift up one last thing before we leave this conversation. We have to heal. We have to heal. Please, everyone who's on this line, who does this work, this is hard work. I know, Joanne, I'm going to just shout you out. You know, seeing the report, being on that board and seeing and hearing the amount of deaths in our Commonwealth, that does something to you. And so we together need to heal. We need to heal and have wholeness as we continue to do this work. And one of the most important things as we round out 1 o'clock is making sure we're spreading the word. Everyone doesn't know. And so we had 80 plus people on today. Let's spread this word. Let's continue to talk about it. Let's continue to share this with our neighbors and friends and those who we know this is so important to. Thank you. Thank you so much. We appreciate you joining us today with the Pennsylvania Black Maternal Health Caucus first inaugural Brunch and Learn. Thank you to our staff that we could not do this without. We give major shout outs to them for all the organization and the planning. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Have a wonderful day and a great weekend.